right, ladies and gentlemen, time to get started with our next panel discussion on technology enabling sustainability. I'm going to firstly invite our session moderator on the stage. We have with us Mr. Ram Chandnani, who's the Managing Director, Advisory and Transaction Services, India, CBRE South Asia. If I may please invite Mr. Ram on stage. He comes with more than 21 years of real estate experience, and in his present capacity, he's responsible for the overall direction, strategy, and growth of the advisory and transaction services business in India. Well, joining him, our next speaker for the session, we have with us Dr. Chandrashekhar Hariharan, who's the chairman of the BCIL Z Homes. If I may please invite Dr. Chandrashekhar to please come on stage as well. He's also the co-chair of the Indian Green Building Council, Bangalore chapter, and is also on the board of governors of ATRI, one of the world's top 20 environment think tanks. Moving on to our next speaker, we have with us Mr. Amitabh Satyam, who's the chief mentor, Smart Transformations. If I may please invite Mr. Amitabh Satyam on stage as well. He was earlier the managing partner at SAP and global consulting leader for telecom IoT at IBM. Our next speaker, Mr. Adarsh Narahari, who is the Managing Director of Mantri Primus Life Spaces Private Limited and Secretary CREDAI Bengaluru. He also serves as the current Secretary for CREDAI Bengaluru. And joining him, we have Mr. John Kuruvilla, who is the Chief Mentor with Brigade Real Estate Accelerator Program. And he comes with more than 3 decades of diverse experience with some of the biggest advertising agencies of India, like J. Walter Thompson, Lintas, now Lowe, and of course, Leo Burnett. Our final speaker for the session, we have with us Mr. Kishore Jain, who's the Managing Director of Jain Heights, also the President-elect CREDAI Bengaluru. And under his guidance, Jain Heights has pioneered in nurturing the concept of style and stature in living standards. Please put your hands together to welcome all our panel members, ladies and gentlemen. And with that energy, let's march ahead. And Dr. Ram, over to you.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. I hope we have a time slot available. I know we're running a little bit late. Thank you. I think we have a great panel, and there was a very interesting session, the previous session that we had. And there was lots spoken about how we can manage developments around transit-oriented schemes and what really are some of the challenges that Bangalore faces. But I think while this conclave is more about what's happening in the southern markets, and our topic is fairly interesting in terms of how can we enable sustainability with technology? And obviously we have a few developers on the panel, and obviously John and Amitabh, who are predominantly on the technology side. So fairly interesting conversation we're going to have. I'll pose this question, my first question to the developer fraternity over here, in terms of what are you really seeing in your developments? And over the years, you've obviously changed the way you have actually developed, whether it's commercial, retail, residential schemes. What are you really doing in terms of creating these sustainable environments? And do you really use technology in creating these environments? Would you want to share your views, Kishore? We'll start with you.
Generally, for the business, there will be 2 major functions. One is to produce and sell. And for a real estate, we have the third function, the third angle, that is the regulatory. So not only we have to build, we have to sell again. At the same time, we have to be compliant with the regulatory authority also. So now see how the technology has played a role in all the 3 aspects of doing business. The first and foremost challenge which we find with the regulatory, maybe the wish list will be if we can have some digitalization with the regulatory authority in terms of the land, in terms of the approval process, although some initiatives have been taken up, but it's not adequate enough for the authority to move forward. Coming to construction, the construction technology in the country was always primitive in nature, and off late in the last 20 years only, from manually, there was a very gradual transition from gradual manually to the mechanization of the construction technology. The one aspect which has been a dramatic or a phenomenal rise or the phenomenal use of technology was the selling part. It has changed the whole aspect, the way we used to do marketing, selling, and other things. Overall, the business operations, because of the use of technology, has become more and more efficient and high performance. This is how the things have been changed of late.
Good afternoon, everyone. I know we have the afternoon session. I hope everybody's woken up after their lunch. So with respect to technology in construction, I'll just break it up because we are here to talk about sustainability. Technology for sustainability, I'll talk about in a bit. But technology in construction primarily around, like what Mr. Kishore said, is your ERP systems, your way to reach the customer, and the way you coordinate with your different vendors. Typically, this is what real estate has been using now for a while. The physical construction as such has not really evolved over a long period of time. We still talk about precast, we talk about tunnel form, but as such, there's been no disruption, I believe, technologically in the physical construction of the way real estate works. On a sustainable side, fortunately or unfortunately, most of us have been driven by government policies and norms in terms of wastewater recycling, in terms of STP, in terms of what amount of dust in the air. So I think the real challenge here is the occupiers or the home buyers are maybe not as much demanding as they would be in other parts of the world, or the occupiers are not ready to pay a premium. So if there is a grade A office space, let's say not platinum rated, and it's going at 60 rupees, and there is another person who probably is platinum rated, he spent a lot of money, he spent maybe 4,500 rupees a square feet, there is no real delta there in the rent which would justify the spend in money. So unless that changes, unless the occupiers of real estate start paying the premium for bringing in this technology from around the world, be it in electricity, be it in utilities, be it in through solar, whatever, there are, I mean, we have better people on the panel to talk about the technologies available. But unless the business case changes for a developer that there is a premium, yes, you have a platinum rated building, you have the most green building in town, here is that delta for you. Unless that happens, I don't see it being adopted by the developer community going forward.
Mr. Hariharan, you've built a lot of green buildings over the years. And very sustainable schemes. You want to share your views?
Sure. I won't come from this the narrower context of just the building sector. I'd like you to reflect on the following. Today we have about 12 billion square meters of buildings across India, built over all time, shall we say. Between now and about 2030, the figure could shift to say 2032 or so, we're going to have another 18 billion square meters by every single account. There are researchers, you know, from within the industry, from elsewhere, who are testifying to this. And there is enough evidence to show you that by 2030, no more than 40% of the buildings that existed in 2015 would be that part of it from the past. That's 60% more would have been built. The second is this. We talk about the realty sector. I know this is a forum for realty sector professionals, consultants, architects, builders, and so on. But the quantum of spend between now and 2019 March, I'm not even talking of anything beyond that, just the next 18 months and less, is about 95,000 crores on highways. The government has announced 25,000 kilometers of rail lines, and that is going to cost them about 145 lakh crores. You divide that by 5,000 crores and you will know, or 6,000, and you will get this many billion dollars. The third is that the government has announced this. This was announced about a year ago, 50 airports, and the cost for that has been set at about 20,000 crores. Don't ask me what those cities are. It's listed, tier 2, tier 3, and so on. The challenge of sustainability and technology is therefore not lying in homes or in the residential sector. It's not even lying in the commercial sector, which in any case is going to grow something like 6 times from what it is today. The figure is no more than about, is that about 12 or is it 14 million square feet of commissioned commercial buildings? I'm not talking of those that are still under construction. Now, what can therefore be changed in these areas? There are only 4 areas where you can bring any change. You heard a lot of the government bashing that happened in the previous session. I wish Naresh was here in Balkrishna because I would have taken them on a few things. You know, solutions weren't spoken about. All we can do is, and thankfully here in this section, we are talking about private sector initiatives when we talk technology and sustainability. But having said this, look at this. Look at this one single data that I will give you. Drone-based surveys for the next 3 years need 150,000 civil engineers. They're not available for just drone-based service. Look at this. Let's not talk technology. Simply because of drone-based surveys, what has happened is for every kilometer of those, eight-lane highways, every kilometer is about 4 acres that you take as land or consume as land. What has happened is because of the precision of contour surveys, the saving in aggregate and in sand has been as much as 27 to 28%, they say. Now, they have not said that, well, we have found a replacement for sand or for aggregate. All right? The lament is still there. Where are we going to get sand? We have no rivers and no riverbeds and so on. But the point is that this kind of subtle technologies, which are not coming because of seminars that we hold and, you know, all the breast beating on sustainability, it is happening simply because of the sheer efficiency of slight shifts in engineering and, of course, the quantum of buildings that are happening or construction that is happening. So if I take just these three segments, which is non-reality, the quantum of saving that we can bring about with very, very simple shifts in technology is going to make a very big difference in the quantum, in the natural resource effectiveness or use of natural resources. We just don't have it. We are on the top of the heap when it comes to water scarcity. We are the most natural resource scarce economy today in the world. We have got the fastest growing GDP in the world just now. We are the second largest when it comes to green buildings and certification. We are at 5 billion square feet. We are on CAGR, if you look at it, we are the second largest only after the US on green buildings and certification. Year upon year from 2011, consistently, we are the second largest, not even China. The last I will say is, there is, believe you me this, this is a human species moment, not just India's. By 2025, we are talking sustainability. 30% of all your IC engines, every car and scooter that you're running is going to definitely by mandate become electric. How is it going to happen? How are we going to have cars which run at 400 kilometers today to run at 1,000 kilometers on a fast charge battery at 20 minutes? This is, believe you me, this is seriously on and real. It's happening by 2025 at 30%. If I go back to the Paris Protocol that we signed, Modi signed after his government came in, we have to reach by 2030, 30% of the 2005 levels of carbon emission. We can't reach it unless you and I, all of us, bring that change. 40% of India, about 400 million people, have to bring this change in the ways that our behavior itself changes. And that is not to do with technology. Technology will foist it upon us, like telephones have done to you. You're sitting, I keep telling engineers today, you're sitting on an information superhighway in your pocket. All you have to do is, whenever you have 20 minutes, open something and find a technology or something that you can use as a solution without having to buy it from a consultant. I'll stop for now.
Very interesting data shared. And that's true. And we are obviously worried. When you say we're going to have electric run cars, the question is, where are the roads? Yeah, where is the electricity, of course? Where are the roads? And it all come through.
Since you raised this about electricity, let me put it this way. In just 2015-16, 1 year, we don't have the data for the current year. I mean, for 2016-17, data has still not come in reliable ways. The quantum of megawatts, that is, every kilowatt saved becomes a megawatt, every megawatt saved becomes a megawatt. The quantum of energy saved because of this one super ESCO, I'd like you to Google EESL, EESL. This is it's a government, private, public sector, energy supply company. The saved megawatt is more than the renewable energy generated in this country in just that 1 year. And this year, the figure is even larger. Institutions like AEEE, BEE, and now BEE is transforming into another kind of organization. They are coming up with some really rapid sort of situations, and they're hitting all the low-hanging fruits. They're taking public street lighting, for instance. They started with Puducherry. That was in 2014, I think. Yeah. So energy is going to get decentralized, and it's happening at the rooftop levels also. You saw this morning, suddenly IFC has decided that they will invest some $15 million in one renewable energy company. And I'm telling you, this is just the cusp of an entire set of such changes, massive shifts that will happen to get you to see that you generate energy at the localized levels. I just thought I must mention this since you brought up energy.
John and Amitabh, the questions posed to you. I mean, you've obviously been involved with a lot of the technology players who are actually working on the real estate sector in focus. You want to share your views on how much of it is going to impact in terms of creating sustainable environments? And obviously, what role can the government play? Because in reality, we're talking of the government playing a larger role here to get things going, while the private sector does their bit. You want to share your views?
All right, so I'll go. Okay. I'll leave the government part to you. This we've been talking about this by 2035. Too many cars, too many people. The requirement of roads that we don't have and housing. I think 2035 is very, very far away. I don't think it's going to be the linear growth or exponential growth of population or the road or the cars are going to be there. I think I propose that most likely the number of cars will significantly go down. Even the travel will go down significantly. A lot of work will be done remotely. The technologies of today will make it possible for most of us to not have to commute unless you want to go on a vacation. So I think things are going to be very different. The energy consumption per capita need not increase as it is increasing today. So sustainability and technology are, if you think about it from the real estate perspective, they are in conflict, right? When you construct a building, you're obviously destroying the environment by definition. Even if you look at a 2,000 square foot or 1,500 square foot apartment, we are looking at using thousands of kilos of sand and cement and steel, and each one consumes hundreds of kilos of petrol. So to make 1 kilo of steel or iron rods, you need about 600 grams of, so three liters of petrol gives you 2 kilograms of steel. So you are already hurting the environment. So how do we actually even look at? So I just looking at the future of it, just like the cars and the transportation, I think even the real estate industry will have to see how do we increase the utilization of existing resources. This is something that I have been promoting that, you know, currently if you look at a real estate, look at an office building for that matter, my office somewhere, 200 square feet office, I use it out of, you know, 7 by 24 hours. I'm only using it for 30, 40 hours a week. Most of the time it's completely unutilized. Similarly, if you look at, so I actually, in my book, I joke about this. It's like having a private tennis court. You go play for an hour and then you're gone and it's available to you all the time. Similarly, your office is like that. So we have to increase utilization. I know we can see the sharing of offices becoming more popular now when you have a conference room that is usually not utilized, now it's shared by people. So we have the in information technology, we have a concept called cloud. So similar concepts are coming into real estate where we are sharing resources and optimizing the utilization of resources. Now, there are three aspects of how technology contributes to sustainability and how you are able to reduce overall cost. And the cost here is not in rupee term, but it is actually how much load you're adding to nature. So if you're containing, you are matching the growth with sustainability by measuring the cost in load of nature, like the number of kilos of petrol or liters of petrol you're using. Even during the design phase, right now, if you look at the Indian industry is about $400-500 billion, planning to hit about $1 trillion in about 5-7 years. That is the kind of amount of money that is going in. Even if you're able to save 10%, you can imagine how much we can save, right? 10%. Now, that 10% is very possible. You look at the research, look at the amount. My house in Mumbai that I built a few years ago, they put like so much material into this, and I'm thinking, how do you decide how much? He said, well, we kind of have an experience. If you were to just optimize the use of materials, of the existing materials today, we can save 10 to 20%. Even if you go to small towns, they don't have any architectural designs. They don't know how to find the right optimum amount of cement, et cetera, to use. We overdo things. I think if you just were able to intelligently advise that this is the amount of material you need, I think we'll save 10 to 20% load on nature. We'll be extracting less material from the nature, cement or otherwise. And similarly, if you are able to look at the newer designs, and I keep joking about this, a typical house costs about 1 crore, and a mobile phone costs about 10,000 rupees. But look at the number of engineers. everybody is going into mobile phone. I mean, mobile means internet, IT, all of that. I'm just encapsulating all on the mobile phone. So the look at the opportunities that we have, where is 1 crore, where is a 10,000 rupees, and everybody is working on the 10,000 rupee product. We should have to direct our engineers towards a 1,000 crore, the 1 crore product, and see if we can bring it down by 10 to 20 to 30%. I think it's very possible if you're able to reduce the material cost, create new materials which are stronger and thinner, requires less strength. What may happen is that the heights that you can build may have to come down a little. With the newer material, which are less, little bit not as strong, you are able to build maybe only 5 floors. But we have to find the right optimum cost of constructing a building by maximizing the square footage and minimizing the cost. So there are many different ways, and I keep focusing on materials rather than IT. I know IT with the drones, with the 3D printing, and ERP and mobility, the huge number of solutions, the logistics becomes cheaper. So the IT will bring in your cost by 10 to 20% anyway. Your total time taken from 5 years to 3 years, that will happen anyway. That's a given. In fact, almost no cost. We don't have to invest much. We just have to institutionalize our processes. But our focus has to be how you relate to the load on nature, to the cost, which is measured in terms of energy and material. So that's the technology we should be using.
Sure. So I'm going to take a very pragmatic approach. I'm going to present data which will stock prove to you the problem, and I'm going to actually give you solutions that can handle those problems. I came to Bangalore first in 73 from Kerala on a holiday. And do you know what was the number of hectares of built-up area and what was the number of hectares of vegetation? I'll just give you data points and I'll ask you a second question. In 73, built-up area was 5,683 hectares. Whereas vegetation was 48,650 hectares, which means 68.2% of the land base in Bangalore was vegetation, and 7.9%, sorry, 93% was vegetation and 7.9% was built-up area. In 1999, the built-up area went up from 5,683 hectares to 25,202 hectares, and the vegetation came down from 48,000 to 32,000. You'll be shocked to know that in 2020, the built-up area is going to go up to 66,455 hectares, and the vegetation is going to come down to 2,108 hectares. Bangalore is going to be unlivable. Add to that another interesting, I love data. In 1973, there were 207 lakes occupying 2,324 hectares, which means one lake on an average was 110 hectares in size. In 2013, there were 93 lakes and 446 hectares, which means each lake, the size was 5 hectares. So not only have lakes shrunk in numbers, they've also shrunk in size. I'll add another data point. 20 years back, the groundwater table in Bangalore, in most places, was 28 feet. Today it's more than 1,800 feet. Stock problems on one side. What are the causes? Lakes are polluted because only 30% of sewage is treated by sewage treatment plants. Out of 18 lakh properties, 4,000 houses have rainwater harvesting structures. Hello? Yeah. Very few houses have rainwater harvesting structure. And the population of Bangalore is going to grow up by another 40 lakh people. Now, this is the reality. You can't change it. Can technology intervene to do something? In this room, there are four companies sitting here. One is a company called EcoSTP, which can actually bring down maintenance of STP plants of builders to zero. Same cost, zero. There's another startup here called VGOT, which for 136 apartment project in Chennai has saved them 1,750 kiloliters of water a month. They save them now about 2 lakh rupees a month. There's a third startup here which uses sensors and reduce electricity consumption based on smart lighting by about 28%. So on one side, you have a problem you can't run away from. And Ram, government, let them govern. Don't get them involved here. There are startups, there are builders, and let me tell you one thing, a lot of builder friends of mine today are adopting technology far more rapidly. When Jayashankar, Nirupa and I met 18 months back, their brief was very simple. John, real estate and construction in India only invest 0.9% of their revenue in R&D. The threshold across industry is 3.3. Can you help us find startups that can help the real estate industry actually deploy their technology to bring in extra efficiency or reduce costs? So that, Ram, is my perspective.
Sorry, I just want to, just like you, John, I also love statistics and numbers. So you mentioned that 92% in 2020 is going to be covered, right? I want to debate that number a bit. Just to give you, I'm a developer, so I understand real estate. The ground coverage, maximum ground coverage allowed to get a plan sanction is 50%. And for your information, I've read that report. I can pull out at least 100 things that are wrong with that report on the statistics. So if 50% is the maximum ground coverage allowed, how can 92% be covered area? Simple, first question. Second thing, you mentioned about lakes. I want everybody here to know that real estate developers are the only people who have multi-dwelling units above 8 units, are the only people who treat sewage. So the water that goes out of plan-sanctioned buildings is actually clean water. They are going and mixing with their sewage water, which is going into lakes, right? So if lakes are sinking and lakes are getting polluted, I think BWSSB needs to be hauled up. I think the private developers are the ones who are actually leaving treated water out of their communities.
I was not pointing fingers at any community. I was saying that this is the reality. And a lot of real estate builders are taking cognizance of doing exactly what you're saying. In fact, a lot of builders that I know in this room are now investing in technology far more than is required to make sure that Bangalore stays livable.
I'm glad that John's turning towards the positive sides of things. We can keep bashing things. We can keep talking about all the grim news and the bad news that we have from the past or into the future. Energy, water, waste, as he said now, all these three areas, any company which has started in the last 6-7 years, forget the last 18 months, has had a CAGR, the industry segments has had a CAGR of more than 25%. If you Googled highest CAGR industry segments in India, you will find nearly 90% of them. Forget startups of today. I'm talking about 2013, 2014. They'll all be only in these three areas. Go back to what Amitabh said, and you must get to reading his book on smart cities. There is a quiet revolution happening. Like somebody said in the previous session, well, there are no government offices here. And we love taking them on, There are something like 600 administrative offices, different cadres from 25 years to, as little as, let us say, about 8 or 10 years, were city commissioners who have now been working on these 142 cities. There are about 17 countries which are coming in participating, not simply at the technology levels. And as he said, technology is a given thing. They are coming in to see what they can do at urban infrastructure levels. $3 billion are being spent. $3 billion is spent for over only 49 projects. Now, don't ask me how many cities. The data is not available on, for various reasons so far, of the 142 cities. The government says that they have done only about 88 cities where the launch of these projects have happened. And I'm not going to go into what the smart city verticals are, where there are projects of various kinds that are happening in these. The point is this. Sustainability and technology, even if they are sometimes in conflict, like Amitabh says, is going to seek a quiet kind of a revolution without us talking about it happening in these 140-odd cities between now and, I would think, about 2022, because that's the date that this government has set. This government is going to come back again by 2019. It's, I think, a reasonable certainty, and they're going to keep the pace going. And as you've seen, no government which comes, no matter what the political party is, there is nothing reversed once it's been set charge. It's like a toothpaste. You take it out, you don't put it back. So every liberalized step is going to stay there. John is right. All I will say is energy, water, waste, air management. There is a guy sitting in Delhi. He started this company no more than about 3 years ago. He didn't do any more than 60 lakhs for the first 2 years. He's done 10 crores in the last March financial year. And what does he do? He sits in a room like this. He will put one gizmo on the table, dramatically show you how at the end of this, if it has started at 1200 ppm as carbon, it has gone up to something like 3000. And he tells you, what do you want to do with the quality of air in your room? And he's got devices which sell at 8,000 rupees, 12,000 rupees. He's disrupted technology, disrupted cost. He's bought some of these things, Breathe Easy Labs. You know, this is Barun. You're talking of another one. So that is, air is the fourth. Talking of materials, Istanbul has implemented this. There are a couple of projects coming up in Bangalore, I won't take names, where a 66-meter building is coming up in, the shell is coming up in no more than 8 months. You do your math on how many slabs has he raised in each month. And how does he do it? And that's a story. Go to anything of these kinds that has been done in Istanbul. Actually, the technology first started of such a construction in Australia. I don't know why Turkey took to it. They are building massively. You saw what Modi is threatening as of this morning. He is taking on the building sector. And he's saying, you guys, if you don't shape up, you've got to ship out. He's saying that there's 40 million homes to be built, and I don't want them to be these luxury homes that some of us builders do. Clear the messages. And you know the amount of builder bashing that has happened in this country for the last, say, 7-8 months. Very unfortunate, but that's how it is. The technology shifts that John's talking about, or Amitabh has said, it's inevitable. It is happening, actually. We don't even have to talk about it. How do builders... I mean, Kishore is doing some very distinguished projects. How do we ensure that in these three areas alone, which is what a builder is actually concerned about, energy, water, and waste, how does he take to simple things like this with no additional cost, with the same things that he has to do? Of course, if you don't mandate it, if you don't use the stick, we don't do it. Or let us say somebody like Adarsh, who actually owns the building, he has got to have maintenance. If he's spending, let us say, 21 rupees a square foot, I don't know how much he spends, can he bring this down to 15? And that delta of 6 rupees, he gets back on some sort of a payback with new installations that he makes, even if it is a retrofit. These are all happening within the industry today. There is simply nothing that is surprising to me, as a matter of fact. Yeah.
Thank you. Coming back to you, Adarsh and Kishore. What are some of the technologies you're really implementing on building your schemes as well as managing your schemes? And have you really implemented them, or... And your previous point where you said, will my customer pay for it, so I don't want to implement it. So are you aware of what's really out there, and are you really doing it?
So Ram, like I mentioned earlier regarding technology, on the construction side, it's more to do with faster, like what Mr. Hariharan was talking about, tunnel form. I think you were referring to tunnel form. So a few developers are using that already. It's possible to achieve a slab cycle in a single day. The real question from a business point of view is whether your sale is going to keep up with your construction. So that's a completely different question. But certainly technology has helped speed up the process, tunnel form, precast, and so on and so forth. But where developers are really using technology is to make their own offices more efficient in terms of coordination between departments, to use their ERPs, maybe SAP, maybe any other product, to get the customer quicker, to reach the... On those sides, we are seeing... And a lot of products are now coming in the maintenance space, good quality building management systems. We are able to bring down the CAM. So a lot of technology is happening around that. Around sustainability, some of the things have now become a norm. Solar for the rooftop, rainwater harvesting, sewage treatment plant. These things were considered as a green initiative a few years back. Now I think if you don't have it, nobody's going to tenant your building. A lot of the good quality tenants demand a lot more than this. They'll have norms in terms of how much of heat your building generates, what kind of HVAC system you're supposed to have. So we are driven, as developers, normally we're driven more by business need. So once the occupiers up their standard, so to speak, I think the developer catches up to that standard. Of course, a few people always break away and try to do something unique. I think the ones who break away, the market is not yet there to pay the extra premium. But most certainly, there's going to be a lot more technology that's going to come into play. In construction, in terms of materials, So in terms of carbon footprint, the process of manufacturing cement actually creates more carbon than the process of putting the building together. So the work that happens below the earth actually gives out more carbon than the stuff that happens above the earth. So I think we'll see a lot more norms coming in from the regulators. Where I really wish for technology to come in is from the government side, because while everybody in the private sector, speed is getting faster, the number of steps before you get to a decision is faster. The exact opposite is happening with government. If there were 10 steps earlier, now we're at 20 steps. If a plan sanction took 6 months, it takes 1.5 years now. So that's very unfortunate, because if a computer can generate a drawing, a computer can approve a drawing. So I really hope something happens on that side of it. Yeah, that's about it on the technology bit.
In fact, the commercial building which we are occupied, which when we have built, we were not aware of this green concept. Designed and built, keeping the cost in the mind and how it can be properly ventilated so that the uses of AC vagara can be reduced. And eventually the building was completed. And one of the residential projects where we, by decision, we thought, okay, let's design a green building. So while designing the green building, we came to know the commercial building which we have done already, it's surpassing the gold standard. And this is how the journey started. And the green building, the green residential building, which we are aiming for a platinum, and purely at a design level it is. It's been designed and almost touching to the platinum level. But then we saw the flip side of it. In terms of designing only, the challenges of designing a green building was. One was architects were never happy. They say that you are somewhere restricting our innovation in terms of the facade design. My cost, I think you mentioned about the cost, Mr. Amitabh. In fact, I would like to add up on the cost aspect. In this market scenario, real estate is going through the unprecedented challenge. I'm sure every developer and every employee of our organization constantly, 24/7, professionally or personally, always keeping cost in the mind. So every time he's seeing how it can optimize all the operations, it has gone deep down at the DNA level. So this is how the costing part. So when we go to the QS, when they do estimation, and because of the lack of awareness of the green building product available in the market, and which are very limited, which gives us a lesser bargaining power to us, and that in turn will increase the cost. This can be one of the main constraints which we foresaw in the green building design. And of course, the design part. And one of the things which we found very interesting, Mr. Hariharan, you can look into that aspect. The pointing system in the green building was not weighted. It was unweighted. So it's all about the points only. There's nothing which can give a weightage to one particular aspect. So the gaming of the system has started at the design level. So this is one thing which we found. And plus, the discouraging factor was, when we go to customers, they won't bother. There's no premium attached to it. When you go particularly to the residential sector, there's no premium attached to it. Although you end up incurring costs in double digit, and somehow you try to constrain that. So the premium is lacking. Of course, there are some intangible benefits of a green building. The marketability is very, very high. The moment you say it's green building, the marketability is high, and somewhere it adds up to the corporate image also. It reflects you are a responsible developer. You care about the environment where you live as such. This is on the design part. And the construction part, we wanted to use for one of the commercial buildings in the heart of the city with the prefab technology. So designed accordingly, and when we approached to the prefab technology, then the challenge was being in the heart of the city, the logistical challenge, and you need that kind of scale to have the prefab technology. And eventually, to cut short, we ended up with the PT, pre-tensile stress technology. So there are, yes, the answer is the design level and execution level. The uses of technology is very, very high.
Thanks, Kishore. I just want to add to what Adarsh, you said. There's a company in the US called Solidia. Solidia has completely disrupted cement manufacturing.
It uses 40% less water, sets in 7 hours, and produces 60% less CO2. They raised $100 million, and within, to your point, 3 years, they were acquired by one of the world's largest cement manufacturers. Another company, you talked of green building. I met a builder, Suhail. On his rooftop, he had created vegetable gardens. He told me, I have three problems. A, there's a lot of water seepage. B, there is you need tensile strength for the pillars, because each kilo of mud is 80, each square foot of mud is 80 kilograms. So there's another startup called Natura, which actually brought in capillary-based cocoa peat, which produces no leakage, weighs one-tenth the size, and comes with manure in the system. So a lot of technology happening. A lot of builders are slowly adopting them. In fact, heartening news, Ram, and you know this, many of these builders are now investing in these young companies, which is, I think, the best thing about what's happening to this industry.
You know, actually, people say that early movers have an advantage if you are innovators and pioneers. Things like these that he's talking about, there's a Hyderabad company I know of. In 2006, he started with vermiculite and a third of what weight and gravity will be, value will be when it comes to pods and plants and such things, you know. And these are things now that are getting to be recognized. Back to what Kishore said, see, if you look at any rating system, and the ratings, I stand by them only because what used to be emotion, what used to be passion on sustainability as such things have actually become methodology-based today. And any engineer down the line or an architect down the line, and I'm surprised that there is an architect who is resisting things when it comes to green directions. What happens here is there are 100 points if you go to an IGBC system. If you go to an EDGE or a WELL or a GBCI rating system, or even, say, LEED, for instance, which comes from the USGBC, or GRIHA, which is homegrown and government-owned, you will see that, by and large, they have things that are more or less the same. There's nothing that is very much different. It's the approach. And as Kishore said, you go with a building, you go with actually intent. Your certification is on the basis of only design intent of design, which means that as you go along and you execute the project, at the end of it, let's say you have not done some of the few things that you first testified to or sought to do, well, a platinum can become a gold or some such thing. And there are challenges here too in terms of what you have marketed and what you have delivered to the customer. There are mechanisms, as backup mechanisms go, for ensuring that a person who has applied is not actually defaulting on any of these things. And I'm not going there today. All I'm telling you is this, that if you are a builder or if you are a service consultant, you are a structural consultant, PHE, electrical consultant, or the green consultant, which is a new crop, and you don't have any more than 120, 130 such consultants across some 18 cities today, and I don't know if your architect is working with a green consultant. What they're doing is this. The first concern that a builder has is cost. Today, you are probably doing at about 1850, 1900 rupees per square foot if you're an apartment builder. And as Amitabh said, cost is a challenge anywhere. You ask any white man who comes into this country and offers a technology, the first thing that the Indian businessman wants to know is cost. Don't tell me about, you know, anything else. I mean, you can talk about your technology after that sort of thing. If you're talking, say, any of these technologies that John is also talking about today, they are coming at, surprisingly, they're coming at costs that we didn't have even in 2012, 2011. Costs have disrupted. Technology has disrupted. I mean, you could buy a solar system per kilowatt at 4.5 lakhs in 2010. I was one of those foolish guys who did that. Today, I'm buying at 70,000 to 80,000 rupees. We have got 140 homes generating 380,000 units, which at the 10x of the central grid is 4 million units that is saved for the central power grid. Someone said this, I think it was Kishore or Ram, I'm not so sure. We have to get the government out of this system. I think John said this somewhere. We have to think that there is no government. And we are in a unique situation here if you're within the private sector and working buildings where you can shape your destiny to somewhat, I mean, barring all those regulation challenges that we all have, you can do these things without having to go to the government and without having to spend more money. I think there isn't very much conflict, therefore, And sustainability, I think, is not a word that we need to be using anymore. We need to do this simply because the customer needs a better thing that you want to give. And yeah, and the building industry actually has moved into a slightly more professional mode than it was, let us say, in 2011 or 12.
Yeah, I've just been told that we have to open up for questions. Yeah. So, should we one last point, Amitabh and John, and then?
I wanted to say that too. That about sustainability, about renewable energy, and so many things that we have been talking about. I sometimes end up looking 10 years ahead. And I see these problems solved already. I don't even see that these are structural problems anymore. We already have in India a gigabit, gigawatt solar energy plants, and these are increasing. I mean, the prices have come down so much. So the energy availability is not going to be a problem. Even the pollution is going to decrease. The number of commutes are going to decrease. Number of new construction is likely to increase just because we don't have any, but other countries should reduce. So overall, in 10 years, I personally don't see a serious problem of sustainability or environment or even availability of energy. And second minor point is that the green definition or the we use those green certifications for our buildings. They have very restricted definitions. So I keep I use the word smart index. Actually, I have created a methodology called a smart index, which is more encompasses many more things. I think it's a little bit more complete. So anyway, another time. Thank you.
I can vouch for the technology platforms that are really being coming in, what are really already adopted globally in the Western world and in most matured markets, and the technology that's already there for India. There's so much to solve for in India. And as John pointed out, there are so many startups in India who are really working towards some of the challenges that we have in India and not necessarily that are out there in the US or in the European markets. So there's enough of technology that's been developed in India for India. I think the key is how do we make it aware to the community as a whole. And others, to your point, in terms of whether clients will really pay a premium for it, end of the day, technology is going to save you money. So do they really need to pay a premium for it? End of the day, you're creating those environments, those communities. I don't see a challenge in the occupiers actually paying for that quality or that environment, so long as you're making sure you're telling them what you're providing. We'll just open up the room for questions to the panel. So any questions for the panelists?
I'm Divya Tiwari. I'm from an organization called Sahas. We are into waste management. My question is, all of you have talked about the standards. Now, the other aspect is there are a lot of organizations like us who are, trying to provide and come up with solutions and technologies around sustainability. Real estate can really play a big role in, helping our organizations like ours to, grow and build capacities. But we often see that, the focus on sustainability remains in energy and water, because the weightage given to this, these two aspects in your standards is quite high. Is it now time to look at your standards and see, what are the current problems that, the country is facing? And I would say waste is very high up there. Can you look at, reframing these standards to give more weightage to the real problems? Energy in a way is taken care of because you improve your energy efficiency, cost anyway comes down. So is the case with, in a way, for water also. So can you look at your current issues and how your standards actually represent the current problems and hence encourage solutions around it?
It's a very important point, and thank you for raising waste. I'll just give you one example. I mean, a lot of you live in communities. How many of you actually manage your waste at home when you dispose your waste? The bigger problem is that people actually don't care about it. They just dump everything down, unless you're in a building or a community where it's very strictly adhered to. While the key is that there are enough technologies available how to manage waste, the key is how many of the people actually really take that to importance and manage their waste out of their homes. You want to take that, Hari?
Divya, your question has two parts to it, if I understand you right. One is the reluctance of a customer, call him a resident welfare association if it's a retrofit, or a builder if he's doing a new project. The second is regulation itself. Why is it not incentivizing with, maybe more points or some such thing in the green guidelines? in order to see that we are able to have waste mandated in some ways or, you know, put into place into every apartment, every project. Now, on the second part of it, I've already discussed it with you. We'll have to see how we mobilize, as you're doing today, public opinion, builder opinion, in a way that we are able to raise that 10 points that we have on the 100 on the green guideline to see if it can be maybe 15, 16. As a matter of fact, in that 10, as you pointed out the other day, only 2 points go for actual doing a wastewater inside a campus. The rest of it is going for everything else, not for wastewater. Kishore, can you, since you have gone through this process, on wastewater, what is the challenge you found when you applied for platinum? Maybe with that we can close this.
Anything on technology also?
So about 80% of our country does not have access to any waste management system, solid or liquid. Because we think about cities, that are two big cities, but if you go to the, if you exclude the top 20 cities, the 21st onwards, all the way to 125 crore people, they don't have waste management. So imagine the Lay's potato chips being sold in small villages. How do they dispose of the waste? Every time I go home, I find that they're lying all everywhere, and there is no organized way of even dealing with it. So I understand that this management of waste, that of course the chemical waste management that we put into rivers, and this is one aspect that can actually be treated. But why are we even generating so much waste? I think we have to be asking this fundamental question, and I keep referring to this in my book as well, that, you know, what is the need to generate so much waste that we have to even deal with, management of it? We can very easily, I looked at our life and I mapped our life into several things, and I realized that we can actually very well do away with a lot of waste that we don't even have to create. So our waste, amount of waste can go down just by simply transforming our life and incorporating more green processes. Now, for example, I assured this bottle, and there are many things like that. Everywhere we go, I am personally generating 1 kilo of waste every day. That's being very conscious. So we should, let us target to generate half of what we do today in 5 years, and another half of that in another 5 years. By then, we would not have any waste to process.
I'll just take 10 seconds on what Amitabh has said on waste itself. It's a concern, all right. I am not disputing that. I'm not even saying this not to see that it's consolation. This is the second public meeting where I'm offering this. Please Google, it will not take you 2 minutes to find out this. 45 million tons waste per annum India generates. Ask what it is for China. The figure is sitting at 187, 190 million tons, four times ours. Ask what it is in the United States. It's at 260 million tons today, and they are a third of our population with three times our land mass.
With that note, we'll just end the session. We can take questions offline later on in the evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to once again request all our panel members to please remain on the stage. I'd like to invite Mr. Santosh Kumar from Supreme Industries to please come on the stage. I'm going to request Mr. Santosh Kumar from Supreme Industries to please present a token of appreciation to all of our panel members. And can we have a round of applause to thank all of our panelists here for another very enriching session. I'm going to request all our panel members, sir, if you may please remain on the stage. Yes. Thank you very much.